Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's try that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. Without those masks, I can hear you now if you actually project up here. I'm excited that you're here. Welcome to First United Methodist. Please sit down and be comfortable. Feel welcome. My name is Ken Mendez, and I'm going to go over a few announcements we have for the day and week and things coming up. I want to let you know that our youth had a lock-in last night, so it probably looks a little tired. That's why. But we welcomed our incoming 7th graders to the youth program, and we're excited about the summer and all the projects that we have coming up with youth, and look forward to finding out more information and announcements as those come. But just know that we have a wonderful youth program, and so if you have a 7th through 12th grader that would like to be a part of it, we meet on Sunday evenings, usually at 5 o'clock in the student building. Vacation Bible School is coming up upon us very rapidly. Gina, do you have anything in particular you want to talk about with them, or just continue to pray for us? Yeah, no rain would be good on many fronts. And that is going to be June 14th to the 18th, so we're just over a week away from that. So if you would pray for the folks that are being part of that, and I know that if you have a heart to volunteer, Ms. Gina will always welcome more help. So just talk to her, and she would be glad to help you out with that. Chancel Bells are meeting today from 4 until 5 right here in the Family Life Center. Next Sunday, I believe, I haven't talked to see him today, but I know last week he was telling me we need folks to help with some pews, right? So.
Whatever,
sir.
Hi, can you
invite
the church? Finally, get 3 or 4 people to hang around. We take one of this. All these chairs, maybe in the Sunday school rooms or something. You can invite
here. Okay. For those of you that aren't aware, we are getting new pews to replace the ones that were water damaged beyond the point of where it's feasible to repair in our sanctuary. There is a church in Rockwall, I believe.
Yes, First Baptist Church in Rockwall.
First Baptist Rockwall. They're donating their pews to us since there's not a cost involved with it. We just have to go get it. So next Sunday, we've rented some trucks, some big loading trucks. We have to take some guys over there, unbolt them from the floor, load them up onto these trucks, bring them over here, and we're going to put them in the Family Life Center until the sanctuary is to a point where flooring has been replaced and we're to the point that we can move these pews over here. So, do we have a company or do we just have trucks?
No, we have a company, a moving company.
So they're doing it, so you don't need a bunch of folks.
Coordinator, I've got that lined up.
All right, perfect. Right.
We can use some help over there, probably in Bolton, though. And like I say, Harold needs some help over here when they get here.
Okay, good deal. Sure. Right. Right. Next Sunday is when we're getting the pews. This Sunday, immediately after this service, Harry needs your help stacking his chairs.
No.
Next Sunday. Okay. All right. Crisscross applesauce.
After that, I don't know.
All right, well, I've muddied this up about as much as I think I can. And yes, Sarah has something she's going to say as well.
I'll try to be as confusing as possible as well. Today is communion, obviously, and our communion offering today. You know, we haven't had rails, so our ushers will be coming by with a plate. And today it goes to the Genesis Center, which supports women and children who have been victims of domestic violence and other things. And I saw that there is a lovely little sheet over there that you can read if you are interested in more information. information about the Genesis Center. So that's today. But I wanted to go ahead and talk to you about next month. Kind of going to get you thinking this way. Our next month, July communion offering, is going to be for back-to-school backpacks. And in the past, we've collected school supplies. We're asking you this year just to make monetary donations. The school district, along with the 40 community ministries, has set a goal to raise $10,000, and they are ordering pre-made kits. It's similar to what your students can order through your PTOs at the school. That way, every backpack will contain the items that the schools and the teachers have requested. Also, by ordering in bulk, the money goes further. We can get more items. So the school district and 40 community ministries have set a goal of $10,000, which is a lot. Each backpack is about, with backpack and contents, is about $40. So I'm hoping that this church can really rally around it and get enough to do a $2,000 donation, which would be 50 backpacks. So I know that's a big thing, but dig deep. And mainly I wanted to let you know that if you really feel like you need to go buy crayons or something, that's fine, but we can do more with just buying all in bulk. So that's what we're looking for July. Today, it's the Genesis Center. So if I haven't muddied it too much, thank you.
All right, now you can reset your brains and get ready for worship. If you would, stand and greet your neighbors. Pass the peace.
Thank you. may be seated, Ms. Gina, as a special time for us.
If I can get all the sixth graders going into seventh grade to come up, please. Learn to serve others and to know that the world is bigger than just themselves, and for them to learn to read and use their Bible. So we give them as good a foundation as we can, and then we send them on up into youth, and they can continue that on through youth ministry. But we're just really proud of these guys, and so we want to take a moment to point them out to you and just call their names and pray for them. And we made palm crosses or comfort crosses for each one of them, and these have been prayed over special just for them, so that they have something to take with them up into youth. And we have Kyle Witowitz and Harrison Maciel, and we have Savannah David, and she got hers this morning in early service, so we didn't forget about her. Just wanted her to be able to see her too. And Braylon Common. I can spell it. All right, let's bow our heads and pray for these guys. Lord, we're thankful for this day. We're thankful for these kids that come here to learn more about you. And we pray that they can do the things that you have them do. We pray that they continue to draw closer to Jesus, that they continue to serve you by serving others, and that they continue to learn to read and to use their Bible, as that is a life skill. We pray blessings upon them. We pray that you watch over them as they go into youth and on throughout their life. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Now let us present God with his tithes and our offerings. Will the ushers come forward? Let us pray. Almighty God of grace, thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit that you infuse us with, that you fill our lives with, and enable us to share the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ with others. May we trust you and rely upon you as we minister and serve in your kingdom. We pray that as we give these gifts today, that they would go for the furtherance of your ministry, and that the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, and that your name would be glorified, both on the earth and in the heavens. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
remain standing for the reading of God's holy word. Please turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning with verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning with the 7th verse. But we have this treasure in jars of clay, to show this all-surpassing power is from God, and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may be revealed in our mortal body. So then death is worked in us, but life is at work in you. It is written, I believe, therefore I am spoken. With the same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you in his presence. All this for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on that which is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, what is unseen is eternal. Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. May God richly bless the reading and the hearing of his holy word. Praise be to God for his word revealed to us. Amen. You may be seated. In Genesis chapter 2, we encounter what is called the second creation story. There's the first creation story in Genesis 1. And in Genesis 2, there is a second, more personal type of a story, kind of a warmer, less of a cosmic kind of a story like one, but a warmer, more human story in chapter 2. Scripture reads, many of you may be very familiar with this. When the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, the man became a living creature. The story is interesting. It tells of God taking the elements of the earth and fashioning a little clay boy. And then he takes of a little clay boy and forms a little clay girl. And then he breathes life into the both. Scientific research has come to a consensus. You know, science really isn't an authority like scripture. Science tends to work from a consensus, what the most people believe, that the experimentation and the observation tell us about an event or a phenomena in nature. Scientific research has come to the consensus that our human bodies are made from dirt, made from the dust of the ground, made from the elements contained within God's created world. And in their investigation, they discovered every single element that is in the human body is also in the soil. Interesting that at least in one case, science
agrees with Scripture, that we came from the earth and our life comes from the breath of God. In a very real sense, then, the human body is earthenware. We are jars of clay, as the passage tells us. We're pottery, much like the communion cup is a potter made that cup, made it out of clay. So God too fashioned us in the same way. Therefore, it shouldn't surprise us that Paul refers to us as jars of clay. Clay pots. Verse 7, though, is surprising. Not the jars of clay part, but the entire context is a very surprising text. In this passage, in fact, this passage is quite revolutionary, but in this passage, we read, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power of God belongs to God and not to us." There are two Greek words. Again, I don't expect you to know, understand, or remember these Greek words. I tell you, we've had some of our students, some of our kids who could remember. We had one student a few years ago that the youth director actually gave them a Greek Bible, and they learned how to read it. Amazing. But there are two Greek words. One of them sounds familiar, the other doesn't. The first one is ostracon. If you have been involved in archaeology, you will know that word, because that is the Greek word for a clay pot. That is the Greek word which literally means baked clay, ostracon. We had a teacher one time who was an archaeologist, and he came and told us about what he called the ostracon, which were little slivers of pottery that if you go into an ancient city and they begin to excavate, this stuff is all over the ground. It is litter. They used to take the broken pots of the clay, and they would write their grocery lists on it, their laundry lists, their financial exchanges. You find a piece of that broken clay pot that said, two goats for one cow, or something of that nature on that. Jars of clay, very fragile, some very beautiful, some very ordinary and very plain. The other word, and this may sound familiar. How many English majors, how many writers are in this room? Any? How many minor? Any English majors? Nobody majored in English? You're just not going to raise your hand, right? Have you ever used a thesaurus? Anyone? Ah, there's a writer. We have some writers. It comes from a Greek word which is pronounced thesaurum. And a thesaurum means treasure. So a thesaurus is a treasure chest of words. It's a treasure book of words, antonyms and synonyms. And if you can't think of a good, let's say you've used a word too many times and you want a different word to use in your writing to make your writing sound a little better, you can go into the thesaurus and you can look by the word you were using, and it will show you some alternate words. It will also show you words that are contrary to it. It will show you words that are both nouns and verbs and adjectives. It will show you all manner of words to use for your writing. It means treasure. The word means treasure. That's a treasure book of words. Paul here is talking about a treasure which God implants into clay pots. A treasure which he places into us. This treasure, it means that simply every Christian is a vessel. A vessel with precious treasure therein. Just as this clay vase is rather ordinary,
This communion cup, rather ordinary, it's better looking than some clay objects. But as Christians, we believe that the juice symbolizing the blood of Christ has far more value, particularly spiritual value. This great treasure which is placed in us is the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ himself. And it is the extraordinary power of God which dwells within us. It is the extraordinary power of the gospel of Jesus Christ which is entrusted to us. To we who have been chosen as messengers and servants of God's kingdom. Holders of the treasure. Sharers of the treasure. Sharers of the gospel. And this treasure of the gospel is placed into we who are ordinary pots of clay so that the power of God will not be confused with the container thereof. So that God's power won't be confused with our power. This power is so great that it can, when displayed, can only be attributed to the Lord God. It cannot be attributed to us. And there is a purpose that we who are weak have the very strength and power of God himself. The word power itself is an interesting word. You have heard a word that is just wanted. We get an English word from it. In verse 7, there is another word which conveys power. It is the Greek word for power. It is dunamis. What does that sound like? What's the English word that you would think of power? How about dynamite? The same word used for power of the gospel is the word that is translated into English, into dynamite, if you translate it correctly. We who are clay pots have the power of God, more powerful than dynamite itself, dwelling within us. That's amazing to me. I think it's so amazing that it's hard to imagine that you have a power, extraordinary power, that those who do not know and receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior do not have. You have a power to share and spread the gospel message of Christ that you would not otherwise have. Have you ever felt God leading you to share the message of the gospel with another person? Were you afraid? Are you like some of us who may be a little afraid to talk to a stranger or afraid to share what may be a controversial message to some people? God gives you the power to share the message of Christ with anyone that he calls you to share it with. You do not have to depend upon your words. If you ever thought, well, what am I going to say? That should not be a concern. God will give you the message necessary when the time comes. That is, if he is calling you to deliver that message. Dynamite. We who are fragile, earthenware bodies have the dynamite of God within us. Amazing. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4 states, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak not to please men, but to please God who tests our hearts. I think the biggest problem of pastors today, maybe the biggest problem of Christians, may just be a problem with us. We tend to want to say things that are pleasing to others. At least we don't want to say something that is controversial. But the scripture here, this Thessalonian passage, tells us that the goal it's not to seek the approval of others. The goal is to share clearly the gospel of Christ, to share clearly the word of God. And some will approve and others will not. Paul was beaten for sharing the gospel of Christ. John Wesley, we think of what a great preacher and wonderful guy that we venerate. In the day in which he was preaching in the fields, they would throw all manner of garbage at him. There is one story when one mob comes and grabs him, and they're going to take him into the river and drown him. And as they are carrying him to the river, something about his countenance, something about what he was saying or singing or something touched them, and they were converted to Christ. And when another mob came to grab him and do the same, the first mob defended him. He was not afraid to share the gospel. That's an extreme case, maybe. But I've known people who've shared the gospel message with their family and have been ostracized for sharing Christ. It happens. You go into some of the nations of the world, and they will be ostracized not only by their families, but everyone around them. But that happens here now. But we have the power of God to share the message of Christ. And that's the reason for it. Not to gain what we want in life, but to be ministers, messengers, ambassadors for Jesus Christ. Now, Paul isn't disparaging the human body here, don't get him wrong. Rather, he's making a comparison. He is making a comparison with the power of God and the weakness of the human body and the weakness of human strength. He's making a comparison. And in comparison to the power of God, we are indeed weak. And our power is powerless. It is because that the gospel writers were weak and insufficient in themselves that people recognized that God had to be inspiring them. It had to be God's power that was infused within their lives. Because they knew that couldn't happen from them. Paul, he was a short, bow-legged man with a monobrow. Do you know what a monobrow is? I have kind of one. It's no glabella, no space between the two. And he was thought to stutter. Moses was a stutter. And yet God chose them. That's why Moses wanted Aaron to speak, because he couldn't. But God gave them power to speak the message of Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 12:9, Paul tells us, "My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness." 2 Corinthians 12:9. "My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness." When we are the weakest, God is the strongest. The word grace has two meanings. One means the undeserved merit and favor that God gives us when we receive Jesus Christ for our salvation. The second is the strengthening and empowering which the Holy Spirit gives us for daily living, for each day. Yet to experience God's grace, we must first know a need for God's grace. We must know that we need God. And Paul is saying that as he ages, he is learning more and more his need for God. I think when I turned 30, I realized my need for God. I know when my son turned 15, he was twice my size. And I guarantee you, he could have probably whipped me, but I just didn't tell him that. But he was twice as strong as I was by that time, twice as big. I knew my weakness. I began to understand that I was not bulletproof, which I think every 18-year-old believes that they are. I certainly did. Again, as Paul aged, he realized more and more that his outward body was weakening, but his inward power, by the power of God's Spirit, was becoming stronger and stronger each day. The light was getting brighter within.
There was a big craze back in the 70s, a long time ago, back in that ancient time, the 70s. It was a bumper sticker. You still see bumper stickers today, but not like then. When we first had an epidemic of bumper stickers, they broke out all over every car. And I remember one car that had so many bumper stickers on the back, you could not see paint on the car. But there was one particular bumper sticker that stood out, and it said, "God is my co-pilot." And I'm thinking, there is something wrong with this. This is completely wrong-headed, if not a naive idea. God is my co-pilot. Get out of the driver's seat, is what I thought. It is not until we recognize our helplessness and our overwhelming need for God that we can fully recognize the extraordinary power that God gives his servants. Co-piloting is not enough. We need a Savior. He must be the all-sufficient pilot. God's grace is sufficient for our needs. Maybe not our wants, but our needs. God has entrusted you with the complete storehouse of his grace. My grace is sufficient for you, he says. If only we would trust him. If only we would call upon him. We have treasure in jars of clay to show the first that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. In the name of God the Father, in the name of God the Son, in the name of God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Those, the ushers, I would ask that you come forward during the, as we say our words of thanksgiving. We begin on page 12. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who are in his grief, repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and so with your people on earth and all in the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their ending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, take eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us.
as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and all these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the hope, the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast in his heavenly banner. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit of your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The ushers come forward. Let me give some explanation. We have these small cups, containers, that have become very handy during this time of the pandemic. And so, if you will wait until we all receive cups, we will take it together. And there is a top film, a clear film, that you pull off, and you can take the wafer, and then there's a second with a thicker tab on the bottom you can lift back and receive the juice, the blood of Jesus Christ. There are plates here which for you to put the offering in for the Genesis Center. And so as the communion is passed, you may also make your donation to the Genesis Center.
blood of Christ.
Hymn of invitation this morning, number 363 in the Methodist hymnal, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain?"
Abide with and keep you today, tomorrow, and for all eternity. Amen.